Hello, everyone. My name is William Mucker. I am a client executive with Camaplan and would like to thank you all for joining us for today's webinar, Diversification Through Alternative Investments in Latin America and Colombia's number one largest coffee producer, with Josh Ziegelbaum, Director of Investor Relations at Legacy Group. I'd also like to thank you for joining us today, Josh. And as a quick note, please be aware that Josh will be answering questions at the end of this presentation. However, feel free to use the Q&A function on your screen, not the chat, to pose your questions whenever they cross your mind. They will be saved and addressed once the presentation portion ends and the Q&A portion begins. Before we get started, I do have a brief disclosure that we want to go through. Everything presented in today's webinar is strictly for educational purposes. Camaplan is a neutral third-party administrator of IRAs. We are not attorneys, CPAs, or financial advisors. If it comes to a time where you need advice in any one of those fields, we highly recommend you consult with your team of professionals. We are more than happy to be a part of that dialogue with your team of professionals to make sure the investment process is quick and seamless. We do not sell any investments at Camaplan, nor do we endorse any products. We will never call you about the next best investment opportunity. We believe that you should always do your own due diligence before investing your money, whether it be your retirement funds or otherwise. And once you have found the investment that is right for you, we will help you open your account, fund that account, and facilitate the transaction into that investment. Here is my contact information. If you or anyone that you know who you believe can benefit from the information have any questions about what is discussed in the presentation today and how it applies to self-direction, please do not hesitate to contact me. I would be more than happy to help you out. And without further ado, I'll pass the controls over to you, Josh.
Thanks, William. And thank you, everyone, for joining us today for this presentation. I'm going to share my screen here, and we're going to go through some slides. Just give me one moment while I get it set up. Can you see my screen here, William?
Yep, looks good.
Okay. So I'm going to be presenting to you all diversification through alternative investments in Latin America, and of course, Green Coffee Company, which is Colombia's number one largest coffee producer. So we're going to take the presentation in two stages. First part, we're going to talk about alternative investments in Colombia. That's a specific region where we target in Latin America. And then we're going to dive into the Green Coffee Company. I'm going to talk through our current funding round, things that we're doing in the impact investing space, and why we and our investors are so excited about the investment opportunity. So my name is Josh Ziegelbaum. I'm the Director of Investor Relations at Legacy Group. We're an alternative asset manager, and we target profitable investment opportunities with a strict focus on high quality businesses in Latin America. So I head up all onboarding, investor communications, capital raising on behalf of Green Coffee Company, our flagship portfolio company. We have over 400 investors as of the time of this recording, just about 50 million, over 50 million of investment capital invested through four formal funding rounds. But first, before we dive into that, I'm going to talk to you about Colombia, why we're so bullish on the region. So the alternative investment landscape and why we see that it's ripe with opportunities. So there's a few points here, quite a few. I have 10 points, which we believe are the top reasons to invest in Colombia. So we're going to dive into each one of these specifically in the following slides. I skipped a few that I think are a little less relevant for the conversation here, but we'll definitely touch on the most important ones, which I think are the high upside and the low initial investment, human capital there, the macroeconomic conditions in Latin America, specifically in Colombia, relationships with the US, history of democracy, foreign direct investment, a little bit of stats on venture capital and placements we're seeing in the region, and then why it's such a good means of diversification for US-based investors. So starting with the high upside and low initial investment amounts, the current exchange rate for US-based foreign investors is the most advantageous it's ever been for investing directly into Colombia. On a purely US dollar basis, investments today cost investors less than 50% of what the same transaction would have cost them in 2012. That's due to the movement of the dollar against the Colombian peso. So due to that, investment amounts to enter the market are therefore naturally lower. And businesses in Colombia providing the high growth potential that we see in emerging markets. There's different unicorns that have been established, such as Rappi and others, making foreign investors very wealthy. This slide here shows the Colombian peso as of today against the US dollar. You can see we're approaching 5,000 to 1 And we were sub 2,000 to one just in 2012 and 2013, and even in the beginning of 2014. There's just been this explosion of strength of the dollar against the Colombian peso, which has made investment opportunities much more attractive on a US dollar basis. Human talent. So Colombia has a lot of reasons to brag when it comes to showcasing its existing talent pool to foreign investors. Although the country has been historically seen as attracting investments into large metro areas such as Bogota, we're seeing a lot of technology and entrepreneurship in Medellin. A lot of investors are taking notice to this, and we believe that Colombia is positioned with very high quality human capital. We see this at our portfolio companies, one of which, Polygonus, it's a 3D art design company located in Medellin, Colombia. They have an incredibly talented team doing work in the 3D art and design space. They also have an academy intended to further qualify human capital for their growing business. It's been a long history of democratic institutions in Colombia. So according to the Global Competitiveness Report prepared by the World Economic Forum, Colombia ranks as the number one Latin American country for corporate governance. The same report ranked Colombia number two for both business dynamism and financial system stability. The country itself is the longest running democracy in South America. I mentioned this in the beginning, the US is Colombia's largest trading partner, and that should grow over time. The opportunity for a revamp in the global supply chain has never been more attractive and positive for countries in Latin America, specifically two countries, Colombia and Mexico. A number of years ago, a delegation of diplomatic development officials traveled to Colombia, and they met with the past president, and they discussed plans to counter what China's doing with its Belt and Road initiatives. As supply chains evolve and the U.S. refocuses key priorities away from China, Colombia will stand to benefit. And really, the COVID pandemic has exacerbated this and accelerated the rate in which investors are adapting and taking notice. So Colombia is a country that offers favorable business environment with a stable legal framework. The national government introduced several incentives to support and encourage foreign investments into the country. There's free trade zone regimes and custom duty reductions or exemptions established. The industries that we see most attractive would be agriculture, tourism, the automotive industry, among others. And the country offers incentives specifically in these industries. And one of which, agriculture, is really our main focus through our flagship portfolio company at Legacy Group. So at Legacy Group, we're excited to participate in the drastic upswing in venture capital activity that we're seeing in Colombia. While historically overlooked by the venture capital market, over the last several years, investment into Colombia has skyrocketed. Investors like SoftBank are entering the market and looking to place billions of dollars into venture capital opportunities. And venture capital activity grew from just $20 million in 2017 to over $1 billion in 2019. You know, there's never been a time in history of Colombia where more investors have been looking at early stage companies and alternative investments at such a large scale. So gaps in the business ecosystem could certainly be exploited, and we do just that. So entrepreneurs are flocking to the region to fill gaps in historically inefficient industries in these markets, such as banking and finance. Opportunities are being generated given the addition of foreign capital, real-world human capital, and world-class technological integration. For example, what we're doing through our portfolio companies. Deal flow is significantly lacking in developed venture capital markets. So firms with excess capital have valuations that up until recently were through the roof. And venture capital firms and high net worth individuals had to look outside their home countries and markets for arbitrage level returns. We're seeing less competition in the market, and the rewards are higher for those who are able to deliver. Population is large in Colombia. It's a large domestic market. The population is over 50 million as the recent reading, and it's forecasted to continue to grow. Domestic wealth creation is increasing, and the middle class is strengthening. Colombia is increasing move to digitalization with its young population has created many opportunities in e-commerce and the connectivity economy. The ability of domestic Colombian producers to sell to a growing and increasingly wealthy populace at home has been growing every year and only adds value to foreign direct investments into the country. And finally, diversification. Many of our investors are heavily allocated in US-based assets and enterprises. We'd advise anyone, given the current structural, political, and monetary issues the US is facing, it's an excellent time to begin looking outside of the country for investment opportunities. There's a lack of investable asset classes in developed markets with potential returns in excess of the current rate of inflation. Inflation's running at a high, as everyone knows. It's been tapering off lately, of course, but the rate has accelerated to a point not seen since 1982. So with the Latin American bucket, there's no better choice than Colombia in terms of stability and upside for investors. So now we're going to move to the next phase of the conversation here. We're going to talk about Green Coffee Company. And before we dive into the terms of our investment offering, I'm going to share a video with you all highlighting our 2022 harvest overview at Green Coffee Company. Just a moment while the video loads here. And this will run about 2 minutes, and then we're going to go back to the slides. Okay, let's go back to the slides here. Okay, so Green Coffee Company. I'm going to talk through the summary of the investment terms. Okay, so the current funding round we're in, Series C funding round, it's the fourth formal capital raise for the business, and we're seeking $100 million in financing, $25 million of which is equity capital from our accredited investor base. And the remaining $75 million is in the form of bank financing. So we opened this round in September of 2022, and we're just, as of this week, two-thirds of the way through the capital raise. We're going to be closing off the second tranche of $8.33 million. We've offered our investors, to date, share price discounts on early investment. So the first third of the raise came with a 7.5% discount, which has been fully funded and subscribed. And we're just finishing up the second tranche, where we're still currently offering investors a 3.5% share price discount through February 22nd, which is Wednesday of next week as of the time of this recording. The growth capital from the funding round will be to further expand our dominant market position and build out additional revenue channels. So we focus on wholesale B2B green coffee sales today, We want to build out a US-based roaster and also a distillery on site at our wet mills in Colombia to process spirits such as vodka and sell those on a wholesale basis as well. The current valuation today, a little bit higher than the time when we did this slide, but 77.8 million. We're in the 80s as of now with the additional capital that's come in. And that's equal to about 2x the current liquidation value of the business. The revenue that we produced last year in excess of $10 million with the preliminary numbers that I've reviewed. And that's up from just $1.3 million the year prior. So we're going to dive a bit more into the business plan and the use of proceeds from the Series C funding round, and also talk about impact investing, what we do specifically at Green Coffee Company on the impact side of things. So in terms of the $100 million round and where we're going to be deploying this capital, you could see farmland acquisition payments and development and infrastructure. That's over $50 million of the budget. Right now, we're just about 7,000 acres of land holdings, and we have a goal to be going up to 15,000 acres by year end here in 2023, and then building additional facilities. So we have two wet mills already. We're going to be building additional wet mills, as well as a dry mill on site at our farms in Colombia. U.S. roaster, $15 million of the budget is earmarked towards a U.S.-based roaster. We're targeting Houston, Texas as a market there. Alcohol distillation facility, that's to process ethanol and vodka from the waste of coffee production at our wet mills, $6.4 million for that, and the balance being working capital. So what's the story of the company? How did we become Colombia's number one largest coffee producer in just 5 years' time? In 2017, we seized the moment to create the Green Coffee Company. We knew we wanted to challenge the traditional coffee industry and build a business that would both generate value for our investors, but also the stakeholders in the coffee business. It's been plagued by generations of underinvestment, particularly foreign investment, and we saw that it was ripe for disruption. So in less than 5 years, we grew from nothing to be the number one largest coffee producer in Colombia, with over 6,500 acres of land and more than 7 million coffee trees planted. Some additional stats here on the next slide. This is slightly out of date because we've raised additional funds since preparing this. 27 farms, 6,600 acres, over 7 million trees, 400 plus full-time workers. Investor base is approaching 400. And we have over 50 million in capital to date that's been committed to the company. The business has received numerous recognitions. Best Technological Innovation in Agriculture from the Colombian Congress last year and its agricultural minister. We're also a member of CEA Colombia, which is the Council for American Enterprises doing business in the country. We really focus on full-time formal employment for all of our workers, lifting up single mothers who are heads of households and employing them in our greenhouses, and really focusing on circular economy and using everything that we grow in our farms to drive revenue. So where are we going? This is the business plan. Milestone one would be to continue to scale our farming operations and achieve a truly dominant position. And tying into that would be number two, duplicating our current capacity and boosting our buying revenues. So we expect to target another region in Colombia. We're already the largest employer in the town of Salgar, where we are operating now and have our primary nexus. So we're looking to build a secondary area of land holdings in another region of Colombia so that we can control year-round production and have more stable revenue streams. By 2023, end of this year, I'd say, early next year, getting that launch of our vodka spirit products being sold from coffee byproducts. We already have now our test facility, which was just opened in the last couple of weeks, and we have construction underway for the full distillery. Roasted coffee vertical to be built out in 2024. So we're already diligencing locations in the US, and we expect to shift all of our production from green coffee or unroasted sales to roasted coffee as we target a 2026 exit for our investors. So where were we in 2021? This is 2023 as of now, but this slide was prepared at the launch of the Series C round. So we had the number three largest coffee producer position back in 2021. And at the end of last year, we solidified our position as the number one largest coffee producer in Colombia. We grew land holdings from 2,300 acres to 6,600, farms from 11 to 27, and more than doubled coffee trees planted. The expected multiple on invested capital in 2021 was 6.4x on $100,000 minimum at the current share price. in this Series C round due to the build out of the distillery business and that whole additional vertical, the further expansion of the company in Colombia and the revenues that we expect to produce from the roasted coffee business, we're forecasting an 11x net return on invested capital for our investors through 2026 at the current share price. So the team really makes this opportunity special. So we're made up of coffee professionals. It's really an international group that we've appointed, headed up by Boris Woolner at the company level. He's the GCC president. He's also a board member. Boris has 25 years of agricultural experience in Colombia, great working relationships with government, distributors, and has done an excellent job driving the business forward and executing on our growth plans. Two other board members at GCC would be Cole Shepherd and Adam Jason, who you see to his right. Cole Shepherd is the founding partner. He is the founder of Green Coffee Company, started the business with the assistance, of course, of Adam Jason. And Cole is, his background is in mergers and acquisitions. He was PwC, working overseas, advising, you know, leading banks and transactions, of course. Adam Jason, full career as a corporate attorney, legacy group partner as well. And Adam has a background in helping companies go public, raising debt and equity capital in both public and private markets, and is really steering the business forward with myself on the capital raise, but also in terms of helping us to solidify a successful exit. So some others that we have on board, our chief agronomist, Carlos Villa, to his right, Leonardo Sanchez is our CFO. Prior to joining us, he was working for Fox in Latin America. Jordan Crosswaite is our US-based sales director. Some interesting guys in the bottom right-hand corner here. These are our two strategic advisors at Green Coffee Company. Chris Kelly is a partner at Jones Day. He's been recognized as one of the leading lawyers in business in America. And then Steve Oakland, our newest addition, he joined us at the end of last year. He's the president and CEO and board member of Treehouse Foods, publicly traded company under ticker THS. Steve had a career at J.M. Smucker Company, president of coffee and food service, overseeing Dunkin' Brands, Folgers, and Steve oversees now $4 billion a year in top line revenue at Treehouse Foods. So as a strategic advisor, opening up really strong relationships for us on the roasted coffee side, a lot of inroads, and Steve is really a wonderful addition to the team. So what's our execution strategy? How do we create value for our investors? We focus on three core pillars at the business. First being best-in-class coffee farming production and green coffee sales. This is what we do already. The bulk of the revenue today is from sales of green coffee, which is unroasted coffee. And we produce that at our farms in Colombia. And we also buy coffee from neighboring farmers and process it in our facilities. As we build that out, that production and capacity will fuel the other two pillars. The other number two being large-scale coffee roasted sales, right? So we already talked about getting into roasted coffee instead of green. The reason for that is that we can make substantially more margin per pound on roasted coffee. And we see a path towards selling upwards of 30 million pounds of roasted coffee a year going into our 2026 exit year. And we expect to do over 200 million in top line revenue from roasted coffee sales in that year. The third pillar would be vodka and spirit production from coffee waste. The background here is really important. Most people are not using the waste from coffee, they're discarding it. 75 to 80% of the coffee cherry, the fruit, it's discarded, but it is made up of antioxidants, sugars, and it has a lot of contents that make it valuable. Unfortunately, it's often used as trash or in better cases as fertilizer. So we've identified an opportunity to create an entirely new revenue stream from the waste of coffee production and are building a world-class distillery on site at our wet mills in Colombia to process this waste into ethanol and then ultimately into spirits such as vodka and gin. And we expect to generate $49 million in revenue going into 2026 from this vertical alone. This slide gives a visual of the first pillar, how coffee is planted, matured, harvested, and produced. So we plant the seedlings in our nurseries at our farms, and then our agronomists oversee the planting and maturing of those cherries. Once it's ready for harvesting, it's all hand-picked and then processed in our facilities, our wet mills, and then goes through a dry milling process, quality control, and then delivered to our end clients, both in Colombia and on a global basis. This slide here gives a map of our acquisitions over time, starting in 2018 and going into 2022. The first acquisition was just over 600 acres. It's the green part of the map. And at the time of this image here, we were at 6,600. And we have planned acquisitions, as I mentioned, up to 15,000 acres total by year end here in 2023. Second pillar is large scale roasted coffee sales. You can see the differential on margins here. Margin on green coffee in the pricing model we have 29%, whereas in roasted 48%. So selling roasted coffee to wholesale clients will allow us to move substantial volumes, increase profits per pound, rather than selling green coffee. These bags on the right, these are through our new direct-to-consumer brand, Abira. We also have it available directly already on our website, abiracoffee.com. The US-based roaster will pump out up to over 30 million pounds a year in roasted coffee. We have diligence and planning underway. We're really honing in on Texas at this point. We have 10 locations that were just recently shared with us by a commercial real estate broker, which the team is actively diligencing. Capital cost, $15 million. That's the land and the build out of the roaster. And we expect this to be completed about mid-2024. Pillar three would be the monetization of byproducts. That's that untapped potential of the coffee cherry. We talked about the percentage of waste that's produced, historically it being discarded. However, high in sugar, nutritious characteristics, and available, most importantly, no extra cost to us. And this is an opportunity that we can't ignore and will allow us to open an untapped revenue source for our investors. Due to the quick fermentation process, we're building that distillery facility at the wet mills on site where our cherries are processed. First, we're going to focus on ethanol, then partners with others who have expertise in bringing products to market, such as vodka and spirits. Some additional stats here on production and capacity. At capacity, 38,000 bottles of vodka per day at our distillery, projected to do $49 million in top line revenue in 2026. And this is for just the capital cost of $6.4 million. And this connects directly to our existing wet mill site. So I'm going to shift into impact. That's definitely a point we want to touch on in this presentation, why it's important to us, why others should be thinking about it. So we drive value at Green Coffee Company by doing things right. Over the last decade, we've seen the global economy shift to recognize ESG and impact investing, but really just a handful of investors are looking at it and a handful of asset managers. There's a lot of greenwashing happening out there, whereas people are saying they're doing things in a sustainable manner, but when you look under the hood, they're really not. I could tell you at Green Coffee Company, we absolutely are doing things right. We focus on value creation, efficiency, making a positive image, and this is because sustainability sells. Our clients, particularly specialty coffee clients, are willing to pay a premium on their demands of coffee with environmental certifications, and they'll support these programs. We have various certifications such as cafe practices, which means that we could be sold to the coffee could be sold to an end buyer such as Starbucks. And then we, of course, this green frog might be familiar for some of you, Rainforest Alliance certification. We've had groups come out, heavily diligence our farms and issue this certification to the company. Some key impact initiatives that we're doing, the sustainable development goals set forth by the UN can be seen on the left-hand side here of the presentation. So some interesting differences between us and the sector average, pension plans just being one. We pay 75% of our employees into pensions. Sector average is just 1%. That's staggering. Healthcare coverage, this is crazy coming from the US and understanding how employment works. Just 3% of people in the sector are given healthcare in the coffee industry. We provide all of our employees, 100% of them, with healthcare coverage. Formal banking is another one. Seems normal. We all get paid with direct deposit in many cases here in the US. Formal banking stands at just 41% in the sector, whereas we're at 95%. We also provide equal opportunities for women. We're really lifting up heads of households, giving them employment opportunities in our greenhouses. It's an entirely female-led operation, and they seem very happy about the work they're doing. I just got back from the operation last week, and I saw the updates, and I saw the team at work, and all these innovative techniques and things that you see on this slide are things that we're actually implementing at the farms in Colombia. reforestation, innovative practices, reducing waste are all things that we focus on at Green Coffee Company. So getting into the financials and the exit plan for our investors, how do we expect to take this full cycle? Taking what we know about Latin America, the opportunity in front of us, executing on a thesis of impact investing, and applying it to this particular opportunity. What does our exit plan look like? And what are those financial projections? So potential exit opportunities, one would be a corporate buyout. So think someone like a Nestle or a larger player who's looking to come in and buy farms at scale, at origin, and that have a sustainability story. So a corporate buyout could certainly be one that we look to entertain as we look for an exit sale, but really preferably IPO is the route we want to go. Another sale option would be a private equity buyout. So we believe we have the ability to attract these buyers in the agricultural space. But with an IPO, this could be the most profitable option for investors and should be available to us as an exit option based on market conditions. So how do we exit the IPO? How do we model that for our investors? We're forecasting in 2026, the enterprise value of the company to be $1.2 billion, which is 20 times the earnings ratio of 60 million bottom line net income that we expect to produce that year, 20 times being the average multiple of the PE in the S&P 500. You'll see on this next slide, it's actually relatively conservative in our opinion. So backing into 20 times earnings, backing into 20 times earnings on 60 million in net income, that gives us to 1.2 billion. But if you look at these comparable companies, Duckhorn Portfolio, Green Coffee Holding Company, over 100 times earnings, Duckhorn at 37.5 on the first day of trading, these other ones to the left, incalculable PEs because they were not producing a positive net income. You know, we think at 20 times earnings, it's relatively conservative. Smaller cap companies will often get higher valuations than this. But for the purpose of our model and our financial projections, we went with 20 times expected 2026 earnings. What does that look like in terms of revenues in this slide here? And you'll find some of these slides in our investor presentation, which I'd be happy to share with you guys offline, which you can reach out. We'll get to my contact information at the end. But as you go through the financials, you'll notice breakdowns of productive acres, production per acre, number of sales that are in green, having that shift into roasted. But really the important numbers here are total revenue and EBITDA net income, right? And then how that relates to IRRs and total returns for our investors. So scaling from just over 10 million in revenue in 2022, we expect to grow to 266 million in 2026, do 86 million in EBITDA, 60 million in net. That backs us into that $1.2 billion valuation that we talked about on the last slide. And this nets out to an 11x net return on invested capital in the Series C funding round, or a 64% IRR for our limited partner investors. Some preferred terms that we have, we spoke about the tranches. There's three equal tranches of 8.33 million. We're in the second one since launching the full round in September. And we're currently offering investors a 3.5% share price discount on investments of 100,000 and a $250,000 level, receiving a 5.5% share price discount. And we're accepting final commitments in the second tranche until end of day next Wednesday, February 22nd, before the share price goes to 1200. Now we're gonna hand it over for any questions that anyone might have. I'll also leave my contact information here. You can contact me directly at investor.relations@legacy-group.co or on my cell phone 609-610-8288. If you go to our website, you can subscribe to our newsletter. Would love to hear from you after this presentation. If you weren't able to catch it live and you're listening to the recorded version, here's my contact information and let's definitely get in touch. But if anyone has any questions during the live portion of the presentation, happy to address those here.
Perfect. Thanks for all that information, Josh. And like you said, now is a good time to use that Q&A function at the bottom of your screen for any questions directed at Josh about the presentation or about self or towards me about self direction. I would be happy to answer questions for that as well. While people are typing and getting started, I'll kick off the questions. What would you have to say about people who are unfamiliar hesitant or uncomfortable about investing into foreign investments?
Well, I would say first and foremost, we didn't talk much about this, but it's a U.S. investment structure. So the way that we've structured the investment is through our U.S.-based holding company. So Green Coffee Company Holdings is a Delaware LLC. All of our common equity is issued out of that LLC. So you would be participating with our almost 400 other investors through the U.S. investment structure. Think of this in a similar way. You know, the assets, of course, until we have the roaster, are primarily in Colombia. So there's diversification into that market and a level of comfort that needs to be had to be investing in another market. But structurally, it's in the U.S. Think of this like you own shares in Coca-Cola, U.S. publicly traded company, but Coca-Cola has operating plants all over the world. So Coca-Cola, U.S. company, but international exposure from both production and distribution. Many other companies follow this suit. Think of Tesla, Apple, you know, they both have U.S. operations, but heavily focused global businesses with U.S. headquarters. So I would say in terms of getting a level of comfort, look at the market, try and understand where you see opportunity. We believe that investors should look outside of the U.S. to diversify, not only just diversifying across industries such as real estate, alternative investments, stocks and bonds, but diversifying across geographies. So looking at other countries and other markets that don't necessarily move in tandem with your home market. So investors should, I mean, people would know this, they speak with their advisors and get traditional financial advice. Exposure to emerging markets is important, and because there's more growth opportunity than there is in the developed world in certain cases, right? And when you think of emerging markets, you'll often think of China, maybe parts of developing Europe and other parts of the world. But with all the macroeconomic instability, tensions with China, it's becoming less of an attractive darling in the emerging market space. So we think our friendly neighbors closer to home in Latin America would be a much better choice and much closer geographically in order to allow them to expand into the US market and have presence here. So there's definitely a level of comfort. I would look at the stats in Latin America, particularly in Colombia, as it relates to this opportunity. You'll see that the country's on the rise and that the region's on a rise. It's been attracting a lot of investment. But structurally, we are a US-based investment opportunity.
Oh, wow. Thanks for that insight. That's a great way to frame it. I do see another question coming in from Heath. How does the projection of continued climate change affect coffee productions in Colombia, or is this a non-issue due to the time frame of the investment?
Thanks for your question, Heath. This is a great question and one that we should be thinking about. Climate change very much affects agriculture, and anyone you ask in the industry would tell you that it's real. You might hear other things from people in other industries, but anyone that works in agriculture knows that temperatures have been rising, weather patterns are changing, it's affecting production. I could tell you from a climate change perspective, we see temperatures rising and we're forecasting them to rise at our farms in Colombia. And we've been proactive in the sense that we plant trees and buy farms at altitudes high enough to withstand the increase in temperature over the decades to come. I do believe, to your comment, that it's probably too soon, non-issue with the timeframe of the investment being 2026, but we do see temperatures continuing to rise. And if we're looking to IPO or sell, our end buyer or investor would also be looking at where climate is at that point, even if it's a non-issue for us. So we've been proactive decades out in terms of our planting practices to ensure that the expected rise in temperature in Colombia would not affect the crops and their productivity at Green Coffee Company.
Perfect. Thanks. Again, thanks for the question, Heath. Encourage more people to ask questions if you have them now while we have Josh live. Another question just came in. Are there any concerns with the newer elected president towards foreign investments and business structures within Colombia?
Thanks again, Heath. Appreciate that. And there is a new administration that's come into office. And we've only heard support from him for Colombian agriculture and sustainability and making the country more of a producer and less of an importer. The new president has said things coming down on oil and gas and illicit industries and wants to focus on what the country does well and does right. The coffee industry is the national product of the country. It's one that employs millions of people. and we do things in a sustainable manner. We're paying people formally. We're really changing the way in which coffee is produced, the way in which things are done. We've received a lot of recognition from the Colombian government. I mentioned this earlier on in the presentation, but we got an award from Colombian Congress last year for best innovation in agriculture. We had the governor of Antioquia, the department where we operate, prepare an opening address at an inauguration event we had last year. Members, people that were present at that inauguration event included members of Congress, senators, political figures in Colombia. So we have great relationships both locally, as we're the largest employer in the town where we operate, and on a national level. And we're receiving recognition for that. There is some fear in the market. You see that with the exchange rate. So that rise in the dollar against the peso has continued over the last, it was already in place before the new president, but it's continued a bit. So it's creating more buying opportunities for us as we deploy investment capital in dollars into a country where we're able to buy farms in pesos. But the interesting caveat is the commodity itself and the product is then resold in dollars on a global basis. So there's some interesting arbitrage-like returns to be had from the change in the exchange rate. I think some of that could be attributed to the political climate, but in terms of the relationships we have with the administration, we don't have concerns, and he's openly welcoming foreign investment and the way in which we do things in a sustainable manner.
Awesome. Trying to think of a question now. Do you have any, so with your experience with IRAs in particular, how has that been?
Sure. I'm just putting my contact information up again while we speak here for anyone that may have missed it before. But we have many IRA investors, some through CamaPlan, which I don't know if I'm supposed to disclose here, but we have investors with all different IRA providers who are very much interested in participating in that way because of the high growth potential of the business. You know, being a forecasted 11X and in a very short period of time, investors are very interested in participating in a tax-deferred manner or in a potentially tax-free manner if it's in a Roth. So self-directed IRAs have become very popular with our investors. I could say a very large chunk of the new investors who have been coming in have been using IRA funds in order to participate with us.
Great. It looks like the questions have been winding down, but I appreciate you putting your contact information up for anybody live here who may think of a question after the fact, or anybody watching the recording. I highly recommend you reach out to Josh with any of those questions regarding anything he presented today. If you have any questions about CamaPlan or self-directed IRAs or how to utilize your IRA for this investment particularly, please feel free to reach out to myself or CamaPlan directly. You can find more information at camaplan.com. And again, I want to thank you, Josh, for the wealth of information you provided today. And I hope you and everybody else have a great rest of your day.
Thank you very much. You have a great day, everyone.